Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis for the date 4th of March 2020. The list of news articles taken up for today's analysis is displayed here along with the page numbers of 5 different editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This editorial is based on the verdict of a 2-judge Supreme Court bench on reservations and reservation and promotion to the members of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. In this editorial, the author has raised 4 constitutional questions regarding the Supreme Court verdict, and he has also tried to answer those questions. So let us look at the judgment in brief, and then let us look at the editorial. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. Before seeing the questions, let us see the key points in the verdict. See, the judgment was given in the 2020 case law, Mukesh Kumar and another versus the state of Uttarakhand and others. Firstly, in this judgment, the Supreme Court has noted that Article 16 Clause 4 and Article 16 Clause 4A of the Constitution do not confer fundamental right to claim reservations in promotion. Secondly, if you see, the Supreme Court noted that Article 16 Clause 4 and Article 16 Clause 4A are in the nature of enabling provisions. Thirdly, the state is not bound to make reservation for members of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in matters of promotions. And fourthly, if the state wants to provide reservations, then it has to collect quantifiable data showing that there is inadequacy of representation of that particular class in public services. Fifthly, the Supreme Court in its judgment said that a mandamus cannot be issued by the court, or the Supreme Court cannot command the state government to provide a reservation. So these are the key points of the judgment of Supreme Court. If you remember, during our 10th February, the Hindu News Analysis, we have discussed all these 5 points and the judgment in detail. So we request the viewers to have a look at it for better understanding. As we usually tell, we always get editorials based on the trending current affairs. So this is one such editorial. So remember these points, because in today's editorial discussion, it is around these points only which we saw now. In this editorial, the author has raised certain questions based on this verdict. Let us see them one by one. The first question is whether reservation and promotions is a fundamental right or not. See, as we know, the scope for reservation for the backward classes is provided in Part 3 of the Constitution. When we tell Part 3, it is fundamental rights. Under Part 3, particularly, it is Article 16. This article deals with equality of opportunity in matters of public employment. If you look at these 2 clauses, one clause mentions about the reservation of appointments or reservation of posts in favor of any backward class of citizens. And this one mentions about the reservation in matters of promotion with consequential seniority to any class or class of posts in the services under the state. Now, normally an argument arises in reservation, which is reservation is against right to equality. Here, what we should understand is that reservation is given due to the absence of equal opportunities for the backward classes, which happened due to historic injustice by virtue of their birth. So, this is the reason why reservation is given to the backward classes. In other words, the author argues that the right to equality is the basis of reservation, as there is no level playing field among castes. So, according to the author, Articles 16 Clause 2 and Article 16 Clause 4 are neither contradictory nor mutually exclusive in nature. He is stating this as Article 16 Clause 2 prohibits discrimination on basis of caste. He is stating this because Article 16 Clause 2 prohibits discrimination on the basis of caste. Since there is no level playing field among castes, according to the author, these 2 clauses are complementary to each other and they form the basis for reservation. But whether reservation should be applied in promotions or not? According to the author, the answer is yes, and he provides a valid point in this context. He tells that reservation and promotion is required because India has a peculiar hierarchical arrangement of caste. So this is the reason why the members of SCs and STs are poorly represented in higher posts, because there is no direct recruitment in higher posts where reservation can be applied. So according to author, denying application of reservation and promotions has kept the members of SCs and STs largely confined to lower cadre job. And the author tells that such a scenario is also seen in judiciary. So in order to get a reasonable representation and in order to attain equality among the castes, providing reservation for promotions is necessary and it is justified and appropriate as per the author. This is why the author tells that declaring that reservation and promotion cannot be claimed as a fundamental right is a dangerous precedent in the history of social justice. And this is the reason why this editorial is titled as A Blow Against Social Justice. So these are the author's views on his first question, which is whether reservation in promotions is a fundamental right or not. Now let us look at the next question. The question is, can a court issue a mandamus to the state for providing reservation? According to the author, the Supreme Court has this power under Article 142. This article empowers the court to pass any order necessary for doing complete justice in any cause or matter pending before it. So in order to attain complete social justice, the court can issue a mandamus, according to the author. So this is author's views on his question about mandamus. Now the next question is whether quantifiable data for inadequate representation is a must for providing reservation in promotions. Now if you see Article 16 clause 4a, it mentions that nothing in this article shall prevent the state from making any provision for reservation in matters of promotion with consequential seniority to any class or classes of posts in the services under the state. And such reservation is for the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes, which in the opinion of the state are not adequately represented in the services under the state. Now this term, in the opinion of the state, should not be interpreted as the discretion of the state in order to give reservation. The author tells that it should be interpreted as if the state feels that members belonging to SCs and STs are underrepresented, then it is in the domain of the state to provide reservation. So it should not be interpreted as discretion of the state. And also if you see this Article 16 clause 4a, nowhere mentions the term quantifiable data in the constitution. So the author tells that quantifiable data for inadequate representation of a class is not a necessary part for providing reservation in promotions. So these are the author's views on his question whether quantifiable data for inadequate representation is a must for providing reservation in promotions. Now let us look at the next question, which is if the state has the obligation to give reservation or not. Now if you see, there is an argument that prevails, which is it is not binding on the state to give reservation. But here it must be noted that when reservation rights are in part 3 as fundamental rights, then it is the obligation of the state to ensure reservation to the underprivileged. Further, if you see, the Supreme Court judgment has interpreted Article 16 clause 4a as enabling provisions only. It means that these provisions empower the state to intervene, but it does not mean that the state is not bound to provide it. So according to the author, there is no argument that it is not binding on the state to give reservation. So the author tells that the state should give reservations in promotion, because if it is not done so, then it amounts to interpretation of the constitution by paraphrasing or rewording and selective reading, which is dangerous. So these are some of the potential questions raised by the author based on the Supreme Court judgment and the reasons given by the author to prove that these questions are not valid. Basically, the author tries to emphasize the point that reservations in promotions are required. So based on these reasons, the author tells that this judgment should be challenged in a constitutional bench. And it is the moral responsibility of the union government to appeal this case and request a constitutional bench hearing. So let us wait whether the government files an appeal or not. You might get more news articles in the coming days regarding this issue. This is all about the discussion of this editorial. To summarize, we have seen the questions raised by author regarding the verdict delivered by the Supreme Court, where the court has noted that Article 16 clause 4 and Article 16 clause 4a of the Constitution of India does not confer fundamental right to claim reservations in promotion. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the issue of delay by the central government in officially notifying the appointment of Chief Information Commissioner and the Central Vigilance Commissioner. Now what we need to focus from exam point of view from this news article is about the Office of Central Vigilance Commission and Central Information Commission. If you remember, during our 7th November 2019 the Hindu news analysis, we have discussed in detail about Central Information Commission. On that day we saw about who can be appointed as Chief Information Commissioner and Information Commissioners, and we saw the structure, appointment and removal of both the Central and State Information Commissioners. So today we will focus on the Central Vigilance Commission. We will mainly see few information about CVC in general, and then we'll conclude the discussion with the appointment procedure of the members of this Central Vigilance Commission. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Know that the Central Vigilance Commission was established in February 1964. It was established based on the recommendations of Santanam Committee on Prevention of Corruption. See, it consists of Central Vigilance Commissioner and two Vigilance Commissioners. Initially, it was constituted by a resolution. Then, if you see, it gained statutory status in the year 1998 through an ordinance. At present, it is a statutory statutory body established under the Central Vigilance Commission Act of 2003. See, this CVC is conceived to be the apex vigilance institution in India, which is free of control from any executive authority. So it does not come under any ministry. Hence, it is an independent body which is answerable or responsible only to the parliament. See, CVC monitors all the vigilance activity under the central government, and it advises various authorities and central government organizations in their vigilant work. Know that through a resolution called as Public Interest Disclosure and Protection of Informers Resolution, the Government of India has authorized the Central Vigilance Commissioner as the designated agent to receive written complaints. So the complaints would be received in a written format with respect to disclosure on any of allegation of corruption or misuse of office, and the CBC will recommend appropriate actions for the written complaints. Next, know that as a body, CVC is primarily responsible to inquire or causing an inquiry or investigate into offences that are alleged to have been committed by certain categories of public servants under the Prevention of Corruption Act of 1988. Generally, if you see, it includes Group A officers of the central government, then any notified officers of the corporation established by or under any central act, then government companies, societies and other local authorities which are owned and controlled by the central government. Also, if you see, CVC is vested with the powers of superintendents over CBI's functioning, that is the Central Bureau of Investigation's functioning, under the provisions of the Prevention of Corruption Act of 1988. And in general, if you see, it as superintendents of vigilance administration in the central government and its organizations. Now let us look at the jurisdiction of CVC. See, we have given a picture here for your reference, which is sourced from the CVC website, which is about the jurisdiction of CVC. Know that in addition to these, CVC's jurisdiction also includes any company where the cumulative share of the central government is at least 51% of the paid up share capital. So from this picture and from what we saw now, it is clear that the Central Vigilance Commission does not deal with the matters pertaining to the state government. This is regarding the jurisdiction of CVC. Now let us look at the appointment procedure of Central Vigilance Commissioner in CVC. See, the appointment of Central Vigilance Commissioner and other vigilance commissioners are as per the procedure laid down in Section 4 of the CVC Act of 2003. The persons who are to be appointed will be selected by a selection committee. This selection committee will be chaired by the Prime Minister. And if you look at the other members of the selection committee, it includes the Union Minister of Home Affairs, then the Leader of Opposition in the Lok Sabha. After the recommendation of the selection committee, the Central Vigilance Commissioner and the two other vigilance commissioners will be appointed by the President by warrant under his or her hand and seal. Once the appointment is made, both CVC and the other vigilance commissioners shall hold office for a term of 4 years or till they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. Next, note that a vigilance commissioner is eligible for appointment as a central vigilance commissioner. However, if you see, the total term, that is the aggregate term of office in both the posts, shall not be more than 4 years. Suppose if a person is working as a vigilance commissioner for 2 years, and if he is to become the central vigilance commissioner, then he can hold the post of central vigilance commissioner for 2 more years only. So in aggregate, it should be 4 years. Also know that central vigilance commissioner is ineligible for reappointment. Now, why this provision is here? Because it will mainly ensure that the Central Vigilance Commissioner acts without any fear or favor to the executive especially. This is the reason why the Central Vigilance Commissioner is ineligible for reappointment. So this is all about the office of Central Vigilance Commissioner and about the appointment procedures of the Central Vigilance Commissioner and the other vigilance commissioners. To summarize, we have seen about the office of Central Vigilance Commission, its functions, and the appointment procedure of members of the Central Vigilance Commission in the background of this news article, which discusses about the delay made by the central government in officially notifying the appointment of Central Vigilance Commissioner as well as the Chief Information Commissioner. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Now let us look at a data point which gives an idea about the abortion laws around the world. This data point presents the status of a very important reproductive, sexual and the health right of women, which is medical termination of pregnancy, which is commonly called as abortion. We know that nature has played its role in such a way that one gender is at risk and one gender is responsible to conceive and undergo labor and to give birth to mankind. And there exists a patriarchal structure which dictates terms to women whether they can abort the pregnancy or not. And we also know that in few cases, protection measures such as contraception fails to ensure that a woman is not becoming pregnant because of sexual intercourse. While While the circumstances about medical termination of pregnancy has improved in many countries, this data point states that in around 26 countries across the world, women cannot undergo medical termination under any circumstances. This means in these countries, while a man or husband or intimate partner can just walk away after having sexual intercourse, a woman is subjected to become mother of a child conceived as a result of this sexual intercourse. So this data point is about abortion. Now, always when you study certain social issues, try to link with the sustainable development goals. Now, in the context of this data point, there is one target and two indicators under sustainable development goal number 5. One is target 5.6, which asks the countries to ensure universal access to sexual and reproductive health and reproductive rights. And there are two indicators under this target. One indicator, 5.6.2, is highly relevant in relation with this data point. In fact, this data point acts as a status report on this indicator. This target 5.6 is to be assessed through this indicator, which is number of countries with laws and regulations that guarantee women who are aged between 15 to 49 years who have access to sexual and reproductive health care, information and education. So this target is crucial to achieve sustainable development goal number 5, where the goal is to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. So this target 5.6 and two indicators under this target are quite important. Now, in this context, through this data point, let us see how far women can exercise abortion as their reproductive, sexual and health right in various countries across the world. See, this categorization has been done by the Center for Reproductive Rights, which is a global organization that advocates reproductive rights like abortion. Now, if you look at this data point, it categorizes countries into 5 categories. Now, you can roughly split into 2 parts. One is from category 1 to 3 and next is category 4 and 5. Now, if you look at categories 1 to 3, the women in these countries who are of reproductive age cannot exercise abortion as a matter of right, even for economic or social circumstances. Here, the tragic part is that around 40% of women of reproductive age live in these countries. Now, if you look at category 1, it refers to those countries in the world where the laws never permit abortion under any circumstances. Even if the woman's life or health is at risk, abortion is not allowed. Now, under this category, 26 countries are present. Some countries include Egypt, Nicaragua, Laos, etc. Now, if you look at category 2, it refers to those countries where abortion is permitted only when it comes to the stage of life or death to a woman, that is, only to save a woman's life. Now, around 39 countries come under this category. Some countries include Mexico, Brazil, Iran, Afghanistan, etc. Now, if you look at category 3 countries, here abortion is allowed for preserving the health of the women, that is, on the basis of health or therapeutic grounds. And around 56 countries come under this category. And in these 56 countries, 14% of the women of reproductive age are present. This includes countries like Argentina, Pakistan, Thailand, etc. So we can see that in all these 3 categories, abortion cannot be exercised as a matter of right, even for economic or social circumstances. That is, if a woman decides that giving birth to a child will be detrimental to her career or economic or social life, she will not be allowed to terminate her pregnancy. Now, if you look why this data point has appeared, because recently the president of Argentina made an announcement where there is a plan to improvise the laws for abortion progressively for women. Here, you need to know that way back in 1970s, India brought a progressive legislation to allow medical termination of pregnancy for our women. The act name is Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act 1971. This act was introduced to reduce the mortality and morbidity associated with unsafe abortions in India. So it entitles women to have safe abortion services. Now, if you look, there is also an issue related to this Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act of 1971. A bill was recently approved by the Union Cabinet, which aims to amend this act. Basically, it aims to expand the access of women to safe and legal abortion services on therapeutic, humanitarian, social and eugenics grounds. So India is trying to make abortion services further progressive. Now, if you look at this data point, India comes under this category 4. This category 4 refers to those countries where women can go for abortion even because of social or economic circumstances. This is in addition to the recent efforts to preserve the health of women. So around 14 countries are there, including India, and this category represents 23% of women of reproductive age. Now, if you look at category 5, it refers to those countries where the medical termination or abortion is exercised by women of reproductive age as a matter of right. Without any specific reasons, women living in these countries can take decisions on their reproductive and sexual health, whether or not to proceed for pregnancy after becoming pregnant. And if you look across the world, there are 67 countries which come under this category where women are allowed to exercise this reproductive, sexual and health right. Countries like USA, Canada, Australia, South Africa, Russia, China all come under this category. So this is in brief about this data point which categorizes countries based on the progressiveness of the abortion laws which has been enacted in these countries. Now the Sustainable Development Goal number 5 aspires to take all the remaining countries in other 4 categories into this category number 5 by the year 2030 in order to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. This is all about the discussion of this data point. To summarize, we saw a data point which presents the statistics about the abortion laws that are present across the world, where it has categorized countries based on the progression of the abortion laws that have been enacted in their respective countries. And India is under category 4. And in line with this, we also saw the Sustainable Development Goal number 5, which is concerned with the gender equality. In specific, we saw about the target 5.6, which is concerned with the sexual and reproductive health of the women. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Now let us see a news article which mentions Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. See, the news article mentions that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights has announced that it plans to file an application in the Supreme Court. The application is for asking to be impleaded in petitions that are challenging the Citizenship Amendment Act. Here the word implead means to take proceedings against. So OHCHR wants to take proceedings against the petitions that are challenging the Citizenship Amendment Act. So let us look at this news article analysis. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now here what OHCHR wants to do is to be an amicus curiae. Amicus curiae literally means friend of the court, that is the one who assists the court by furnishing information or advice regarding questions of law or fact. So in this case, as amicus curiae, OHCHR wants to focus on providing an overview of relevant and applicable international human rights standards and norms. It is basically to support the court's deliberations in the context of its review of the Citizenship Amendment Act. Now, if you look at this move by OHCHR, it is an unprecedented move and it is a very rare move. So, for this announcement by OHCHR, the Union Ministry of External Affairs has responded that the United Nations body had no right to file a petition like this. Also, if you see, this move by OHCHR has been criticized by diplomatic and legal experts. Now, why they criticize? Because the Citizenship Amendment Act is an internal matter of India and it concerns the sovereign right of the Indian Parliament to make laws. So the experts believe that no foreign party has any locus standi or right to appear in court on issues pertaining to India's sovereignty. Also, the experts believe that the Citizenship Amendment Act has to be tested on the standards of the Indian Constitution and not on the standards of UN Convention. They also worry that if such interventions as amicus curiae are followed, then it will set a wrong precedent. Now, we have to wait and see what decision the Supreme Court is going to take. So this is all about this news article. Now, what we need to know from exam point of view is about this Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. It is also known as UN Human Rights. See, it was created by the member states of the United Nations in 1993. It is the leading UN entity on human rights. Also know that UN Human Rights is part of the United Nations Secretariat, which is a principal organ of UN. See, the United Nations General Assembly entrusted this OHCHR with a unique mandate to promote and protect all human rights for all people. So the United Nations Human Rights Program aims to ensure that the protection and enjoyment of human rights is a reality in the lives of all people. Now, if you look at the mandate of this OHCHR, it includes preventing human rights violations, then securing respect for all human rights, then promoting international cooperation to protect human rights, then coordinating the human rights related activities throughout the United Nations, and also strengthening and streamlining the United Nations system in the field of human rights. So these are the important mandates of this OHCHR. Also, if you see, it plays a crucial role in safeguarding the integrity of the three interconnected pillars of the United Nations, which are peace and security, human rights, and finally development. In addition to this, UN Human Rights provides assistance in the form of technical expertise and capacity development in order to support the implementation of international human rights standards. So it associates with the governments across the world, since the governments bear the primary responsibility for the protection of human rights in their country. So it helps them to fulfill their obligations, and it also supports individuals to claim their rights. Know that the headquarters of OHCHR is at Geneva in Switzerland, and the High Commissioner heads this OHCHR, also called as UN Human Rights. Here you also need to know that the High Commissioner is the principal human rights official of the United Nations. So this is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we have seen about the office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights based on this news article, which discusses about the intention of OHCHR to take part in the proceedings against the petitions that are challenging the Citizenship Amendment Act, which is an internal matter of India. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Let us look at this question, which is based on this editorial discussion, which is about COVID-19. If you remember, yesterday we saw many news articles about COVID-19, and today also we have a lot of news articles and editorials related to this COVID-19. If you remember, yesterday we saw that so far 5 cases of COVID-19 has been reported in India, 3 from Kerala, 1 from Delhi, and 1 from Hyderabad. And yesterday, if you see, one more case has been reported from Jaipur. So the entire country is on a high alert in order to contain the spread of COVID-19. Know that COVID-19 is the official name of the disease, which is caused by the 2019 novel coronavirus. The official name of this virus is SARS-CoV-2. Now, if you look at this editorial, it mentions about Integrated Disease Surveillance Program Network. It tells that this IDSP network is in hot pursuit to trace people who have come in contact with the 6 people whose samples have been sent for confirmation. If you remember, during our 15th February analysis, we saw about 3 steps of contact tracing when we saw an editorial about the actions taken by the state of Kerala in containing COVID-19. Know that the 3 basic steps involved in contact tracing are contact identification, contact listing, and contact follow-up. So in this context, let us see about this Integrated Disease Surveillance Program Network in brief. Know that this project is managed by the National Center for Disease Control, which comes under the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. See, it is a pan-India network to trace and monitor the outbreak of diseases. For this purpose, there is a central surveillance unit which is located at Delhi, and there are state surveillance units which are located at all states and the union territories, and there are also district surveillance units located at all districts across India. Now, this IDSP is mandated with integration and decentralization of surveillance activities, and it is also mandated with training of surveillance officers. Then if you see, this IDSP uses the information communication technology to carry out disease surveillance activities. So under this IDSP project, a weekly surveillance data on epidemic prone diseases are being collected, and this data is fed to the network on a weekly basis by the primary healthcare centers, then community health centers, hospitals, labs, which are located across India. And with the help of this data, the IDSP traces and monitors all the potential infectors. Once they are identified, they are kept either under house isolation or under community surveillance. So now this IDSP network is also handling this COVID-19 outbreak in India. It is in the process of tracing those people who have come in contact with the 6 people whose samples have been sent for confirmation of this SARS-CoV-2 virus. Now, if you look at this editorial, the author insists that at least 2 negative tests must be obtained before a person is certified as being uninfected with this SARS-CoV-2 virus. So this is all that you need to know about from this editorial. Now, with this background information in mind, let us look at this question, which is about Integrated Disease Surveillance Program. 2 statements are given, and you need to choose the correct statement or statements. Look at the first statement. It tells that IDSP is an IT-enabled disease surveillance system for epidemic-prone diseases. Yes, this statement is correct. Now, look at the second statement. It tells that IDSP functions under the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This statement is also correct. Now, you need to choose the correct statements from this question. The correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, let us look at one more question, which is based on this news article. In this question, you can see the bovine species listed on the left-hand side, and the locations are given on the right-hand side. You need to choose the correct pairs. Now, if you look at this news article, it discusses about the significance and conservation of the native breeds of cattle, especially from the state of Tamil Nadu. It mentions some 5 breeds of cattle. They are Kangayam, Umbalacheri, Pulikulam, Alambadi and Bargur. See, all these cattle are the native breeds of Tamil Nadu. The government of Tamil Nadu has put a lot of conservation efforts into protecting these breeds. Now, if you look at both these tables, it lists out the important native cattle breed and the buffalo breeds of India. So, just have a look at both these tables for your reference. See, India has a large bovine population with rich biodiversity. And if you look, these breeds have evolved over generations and they have survived due to their adaptability to harsh climatic conditions of India. They were able to perform even on poor quality of feed and fodder, and they also had high resistance to diseases. But if you see in the recent years, there has been a significant decline in their population. This is mainly due to the induction of non-indigenous breeds into India. Now, what differentiates between the native breeds and the non-indigenous breeds is that the non-indigenous breeds have high lactating capacity, that is, they can secrete more milk when compared to the native breeds. So, this has led to significant decline of the population of native cattle breeds. Now, if you look at this news article, it discusses about selective breeding and scientific management. Know that in order to arrest the decline of the population of indigenous breeds, the government is pushing for genetic improvement. So, in line with this, the central government launched Rashtriya Gokul Mission in the year 2014 for development and conservation of indigenous breeds through selective breeding. And the government's statistics show that up to 2018, more than 1.26 crore animals were identified under this Rashtriya Gokul Mission. Now, if you look at the objectives of the scheme, one of the main objectives is to undertake breed improvement program for indigenous breeds in order to improve the genetic makeup of the cattle breeds and also to increase the population. And next objective is to enhance milk production and productivity of the indigenous bovine species. So, through genetic improvement, the productivity can be improved and also the decline in the population can be arrested. So, these are the main objectives of this Rashtriya Gokul Mission. Now, if you look at this news article, it suggests that approach to native breeds should be based on a multi-purpose economic model rather than just focusing on the milk production. So, by developing and conserving the native breeds, the economic interests of the farmers can be protected. And this will also help in realizing the goal of doubling farmers' income by 2022 in one way. So, this is all that you need to know from this news article. Now, based on the tables that we saw, let us try to attempt this question. See, Kangayam is native cattle breed of Tamil Nadu. So, the first pair is incorrect. Now, look at the second pair, Bunny Gujarat. It is correct. Bunny is native to Gujarat and it is seen mostly near the Bunny grasslands of Gujarat. The Maldaris, who are the pastoral community, reared these Bunny buffalo breeds. Now, look at the third pair, Punganur, Tamil Nadu. Know that Punganur cows are among the world's shortest cows. They are native to Chittur, which is located in the state of Andhra Pradesh. So, the third pair is wrong. Now, look at the fourth pair, Neeli Ravi, Punjab. This pair is correct. Neeli Ravi is the native buffalo breed of Punjab. So, the second and the fourth pair are correct. The correct answer is option B, 2 and 4 only. This is all about the discussion of this news article. Now, let us move on to the next news article. This news article highlights a possible way of deploying the drones for agricultural purpose. See, there is only one important point from this news article. The drones are being deployed for the application of fertilizers in the agricultural fields of Kerala. If you see, there is a topic in your General Studies Paper 3, E-Technology in the Aid of Farmers. So, this news article is an example of e-technology which will aid the farmers to increase their productivity. This news article tells that deploying drones have reduced the requirement of human labor in agriculture. So, this is all about this news article. Now, let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Look at this question. Two statements are given related to Central Vigilance Commission and Central Information Commission. The first statement tells that both the Central Vigilance Commission and the Central Information Commission are statutory bodies. Yes, this statement is correct. Know that Central Vigilance Commission gained statutory status in the year 1998 through an ordinance. At present, it is a statutory body established under the Central Vigilance Commission Act of 2003. And the Central Information Commission is formed as per the Right Information Act of 2005. So, the first statement is correct. Now, look at the second statement. It tells that the term of office of Central Vigilance Commissioner and Central Chief Information Commissioner is the same. We saw that for Central Vigilance Commissioner and other vigilance commissioners, the term of office is 4 years or till they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. Whereas for the Central Information Commissioner and other information commissioners, the tenure is cut to 3 years. This is as per the amendment made to the RTI Act in 2019. So, we can see that the term of office for both these posts are different. It is not the same. So, the second statement is incorrect. Now, you need to choose the correct statement or statements. The correct answer here is option A, 1 only. Now look at this map-based question. You need to arrange the following countries from east to west. The countries given here are Mauritania, Laos, Nicaragua, Argentina, and South Africa. Now if you look at this map, Laos is located east when compared to the rest of the countries. To the west of Laos, you can find the country of South Africa, and then Mauritania, and then you have Argentina from South America, and finally the country of Nicaragua. So the correct answer to this question is option C. Now look at this question, which is on the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. Two statements are given and you need to choose the correct statements. Look at the first statement. It tells that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights is also known as the United Nations Human Rights Council. See, this statement is wrong because the UN Human Rights Council is a completely distinct entity from OHCHR. Because for both these entities, different mandates have been given by the United Nations General Assembly. But if you see, OHCHR provides substantive support for the meetings of the Human Rights Council and follow up to the Council's deliberations. Know that the Human Rights Council was established in 2006 by the General Assembly and it reports directly to the United Nations General Assembly. And also know that this Human Rights Council replaced the 60-year-old United Nations Commission on Human Rights as the key United Nations intergovernmental body responsible for human rights. This Human Rights Council consists of state representatives. It is primarily a political body with a comprehensive human rights mandate, and it is also a forum empowered to prevent abuses, inequity and discrimination with an aim to protect the most vulnerable people and expose the perpetrators. This council is made up of 47 United Nations member states who are elected by the United Nations General Assembly. So the first statement is incorrect because during our discussion, if you remember, we told that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights is also called as UN Human Rights. So UN Human Rights is different from the United Nations Human Rights Council. Now look at the second statement. It tells that despite being a principal organ of United Nations, OHCHR is a part of United Nations Secretariat. Here know that OHCHR is a part of UN Secretariat, but it is not a principal organ of United Nations. The principal organs or the main organs of the United Nations are General Assembly, the Security Council, the Economic and Social Council, the Trusteeship Council, the International Court of Justice, and the UN Secretariat. So under this UN Secretariat, this OHCHR is a part. So the second statement is also wrong. Now you need to choose the correct statements for this question. The correct answer is option D, neither one nor two, since both the statements are incorrect. Now let us look at a mains question. The question is, critically examine the recent Supreme Court's judgment on reservations and reservation for promotion to the members of scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes with reference to the scope for reservations for backward classes provided in Indian Constitution. Try to answer this question in 250 words. It is a 15 marks question. Please post your answers in the comment section. We shall review your answers and give suitable suggestions and feedback within a reasonable time frame. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, press the like button, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.